Cash budgets is our next topic, where we pull the pieces together and we say, okay, when we look at how much time it takes us to convert inventory to sale and how much time it takes us to convert a sale to cash collections and how fast do we have to pay our vendors, we pull that together and see if we're in trouble or not. What do I mean by trouble? We may be profitable and yet our balance sheet might be such that we're running out of cash. So that's what we're going to illustrate. We're going to create a base case with specific assumptions about our receivables, inventory, and payables. And then we're going to look at several months to see if we look okay, cash positive. Now, note that sometimes you're okay for the end of a quarter or end of a year, but within the quarter or within the year, there are certain months where you're short of cash. And that's what we're looking for. We're looking at, are there any possible issues with being short on cash in any of the months that we analyze? This will become the basis of some sensitivity analysis and scenario analysis. We're not going to do it in this lecture, but if you look at the book and the toolkits, you'll see it in there where we take this base case budget and then we try some other tools to assess the risk and quantify the variation if we're wrong in our base assumptions. This is the budget form, which we absolutely will need to go to Excel, and we'll go this right now and explain how this spreadsheet is structured. All right, here's some base assumptions for our model, and those assumptions are that the percent of customers that take discounts and pay in the first month is 20%. Secondly, who doesn't take the discount but pays us in the second month? That's 70%. And who's slow paying? And these are people that don't pay in months one or two. That is the amount that we receive in the third month, and we estimate that at 10%. As far as payment policy and previously approved payments, we have purchases as a function of next month's sales of 60%. The other payments that are just here for future use in scenario or sensitivity planning is 30, and construction costs. In the month of September, which is within the range of months we're analyzing, we need to spend $150, in this case, $150,000. Here's our credit policy for our current customers. The discount that they receive would be 2% if they pay within 10 days. Otherwise, it's due in 60. That's a bit generous, the 60. And the bad debt would be reduced by third month's payments. And in this case, for now, base case is zero. And the sales changes after the base case also is zero. So we're allowing ourselves, by the design of this assumption section, is to do some further analysis, testing the risk of the model later on. But we'll just start with the base case at this time. We then move to the actual model. And what we see is the sales are here and they're given. The adjustment is zero right now. Again, this is a base case. So the adjusted, the amount of sales is there on row 44. Now we start doing the cash projections. So we see how much do we get collections for the month of July? This formula is that we're going to get a certain percent, and that's 20% of this month's sale in the month of the sale, but they're going to take the discount. So we're going to have the amount of sales, which is right there, 300 times J6. We'll just go up there to show it. So J6 is the percent who take the discount. And then the next part is 1 minus the discount is what we recoup because we won't get 100% of it. We'll get some lesser percent. How much less? 2% less. So the amount we collect in July for July sales is 300 times 20% times 98%. And that leads to 58. And we just copy that formula across for the months. And so each month, as you can see, because of our absolute referencing, it works for each month. Then we do the next one, which is how much in July do we collect from the prior month? And this one is 70% of the prior month sales. There's no discount available here. So this is a simple one. It's 70% of June sales. And then next is 10% of May sales. So in the month of July, we have sales collections for the month of July, June, and May. And that staggered effect happens all the way across to December. And we then can total those and get how much do we collect in cash in the month. Now notice it doesn't match our sales. We had sales of 300, but we're only expecting collect 253. So this shows that we need to do cash analysis, which is different from our normal income statement sales analysis. So after we get our collections, next we have to figure out how much do we have to pay for all the expenditures. The first is the purchases we make have a lag effect. At the end of June, we need to have on hand the inventory that we need to have for the month of July. And the assumption given was at 60%. So up above, we see the assumption of 60%. So 60% of next month's sales is how much we need to have on hand at the end of June. So we do that for each of the months. Let's just look in the middle. That is 60% of October sales is what we need at the end of September. We then can look at our payments for those purchases. We were told that we need to pay all our vendors within 30 days. So this 180 that we ordered and got in June, we will pay for in July. And you see that it's staggered 300, 300, 150, 150, right? So this row represents the magnitude of our purchases, but it's not cash. Here's the cash flow showing when we pay with that 1 month lag. These other two in blue are just assumptions we have for ongoing wages, salaries, and lease payments. The other payments is linked to above, and this is one we're having static at 30 right now. Taxes are our input here in blue, that we're going to pay taxes twice during this time period, once in the month of September and once in the month of December. And the last item here is this payment for plant construction. Again, this 150 is found up here, 150. All right. So when we add up all the payments we're going to make, we end up with this row of information, which is 270 going to 240 by the end of December. If we now do the subtraction of the amounts we got in cash, which is 253 minus what we spend, which is 270, the difference there is this number. It is the difference between cash collected and cash paid. We're negative 16. Now, in the policies above, we have a target of 10. So now we've gone the other way. We need 16 just to cover our bills, plus we need another 10 to maintain our minimum cash. So we need to borrow 26. We need to borrow 26 for 16, which is a shortfall, plus 10 is what we need to have on hand. We do this for each of the months, and we find that we have shortfalls in these four months, and then the November, December comes, and then we flip the other way, and we actually have more cash on hand. So when we end up with 227, we might say, hey, we're ending up in a positive in December, so we don't need any working capital loans. Wrong. In four of those previous months, you're short on cash, and you need to have some ability to make your payments to your vendors on time. Next, if we look at these 6 months, the maximum amount required for a loan is the smallest number here, the biggest negative specifically. You could see it's right there, 234. The formula is the min formula, so give me the minimum between the 6 months that we're projecting. Next is, what is the maximum investable funds? Here, the maximum of those, which is 27. So we happen to end the year with a lot of cash, and we'll be able to invest some of that. We happen to have a trough, or kind of the low point in our cash flow, in the month of September, right here. So we need to have in place some form of line of credit or short-term loan so that we can have an extra $234,000 by the end of September. Sure, everything goes fine in December, but what if we don't get there, if we don't pay our bills? So that's why we need to analyze at a monthly basis to get to our net cash needs through the entire six-month period that we're projecting. Next, we'll do a couple of observations of cash budgets versus other statements we've looked at, like the income statement and the free cash flow. Cash budget is as stated. We're focused on cash, not about accruals, not about anything that is receivables. We want to know how much cash do we collect and how much cash do we pay. And that's what we're looking at. This is a cash basis statement. So it's quite different from the other two. The next is income statement, which is GAAP and accrual basis. And we show revenue when earned, whether or not we collect it. And we show expenses when incurred, whether or not we paid it. So accrual basis is quite different from cash basis. And these two we have here, cash budgets and income statements, are very, very different in that regard. Next is free cash flow, which has a blend. To calculate NOPAT, net operating profit after tax, we use accrual basis numbers to get to NOPAT. Then we make adjustments based on what happens to the balance sheet. Those are the change in the operating assets or net operating assets, and that gets us the free cash flow. So cash budget is cash basis, income statement is accrual basis, and free cash flow has a blend of accrual for NOPAT and looking very carefully at the balance sheet to look at changes that require cash investments in the net operating asset section that adjust to arrive at free cash flow.